First of all, as many of you know, John Allen is the associate editor of the Boston Globe and Crux, the Globe's website covering Catholicism. Perhaps, I think it's still, it's the first and perhaps the only such secular paper that has a particular emphasis on Catholicism. In addition, John is a senior Vatican analyst for CNN. He was a correspondent for the National Catholic Reporter for 16 years. He's the author of 10 books. Brian mentioned that Mark has at least two of them over there. They have all dealt in some fashion with the Vatican and/or with Catholic affairs. John is a very popular speaker on Catholicism and on the papacy, not only here in the United States, but internationally. And we are really blessed to have him come and be with us here in Louisville and in the Archdiocese. One of the personal notes that Sal mentioned in his effort is that, John, your family has a pet, and it's you're an avid pug lover, and that your pet's name is Ellis.
Right.
And his birthday was September 29th. What more do you need to know?
That sums it up.
Yes, exactly. Now, I wasn't sure if Ellis is Albert Ellis. I studied family therapy, and I know Albert Ellis was one of the giants, or Ellis Island, which talks about immigrants, but you can fill us in on that.
Ellis Island. One island, one bread.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful. Well, listen, we'll look forward to some photographs at the break. One of the things that I shared with John when we met privately before we began today was something that I don't say lightly, and that is that John Allen has the reputation of a person with journalistic integrity. And that is something that should not be said quickly about people. He's someone who does seek in love and charity the truth, and he tries to find the right way to say it. And we have been blessed with his contributions over these last few decades, and most especially, most recently. Please join me in welcoming John Allen.
Your Archbishop and I just spent the better part of a month in Rome. The Archbishop is one of the protagonists, even the recently concluded Synod of Bishops, and I, of course, was covering it. This two-synod process, okay, the first synod on the family last October and the one that just wrapped up a couple weeks ago, I wouldn't exactly call it Mr. Toad's wild ride. But it did have its moments of drama and occasionally tension and so on. I don't think I'm going to be arrested by the Vatican gendarmes for revealing confidential information if I tell you that. And I want to have the chance to say, Archbishop, how valuable I think your leadership was during this entire process. You never ducked the hard questions. You always engaged them head on, but you engaged them with great sanity and with great balance, without a trace of partisanship or personal animosity. Those were qualities that were sorely needed for this process, and I think deeply appreciated. And also, you were at times not quite a lone voice, but one of the few voices, relentlessly insisting that we had to keep our eyes on the big picture, that is, we shouldn't become so consumed by how we respond to problematic situations, but we forget the real challenge here is how to deploy the best resources of the church to support families where they flourish. And that flourishing families are not rare or exceptional, they're more common than we think, and they deserve the last best measure of our efforts to have their backs. And that message came through clearly from you. And I think in that sense, the final document to some extent bears the imprint of that message. So I want to have a chance this morning to say thank you. Thank you not just on the behalf of the Catholics of Louisville, who of course benefit from your leadership all the time. Wait for it. But I want to say thank you on behalf of all of the Catholics in this country who have benefited from your leadership perennially, but certainly these last couple of years as president of the conference. And also the universal church, because of course the work product of that synod doesn't speak just to the situation in the United States, it speaks to the situation of the church globally. And so although I have no mandate to do this, on behalf of 1.2 billion Catholics around the world, Archbishop, I want you to hear me say thank you, thank you, thank you. By the way, for those of you who do a lot of public speaking, I really recommend this to you as a rhetorical strategy. Always start by flattering your host. If you do that, you can usually get away with murder. Now let's test that theory, shall we? By moving into the heart of today's presentation, I've been asked to speak to you about the small matter of the future of the Catholic Church. Let me give you two caveats right off the top of the bat about the limits of futurology as a discipline and my contribution to it. General observation, predicting the future reminds me a lot of the way Bob Dole once described the vice presidency. He said it's a great gig because it's all indoor work and there is no heavy lifting. Well, there is no heavy lifting involved with predicting the future either, because the thing about it is, at the moment you make these predictions, you cannot possibly be wrong, and by the time you can be proved wrong, most people have already forgotten what you said. So it is, in some ways, a kind of dilettante-esque exercise. And further, let me say, trying to predict the future of the Catholic Church in the era of Pope Francis, in my opinion, comes pretty close to the dictionary definition of a fool's error. Because, you know, many things could be said about this pope, but I think one thing we could all agree on is that unpredictable, deserves pride of place on the list. I mean, I have sometimes jokingly said, this pope ought to come with a warning label like a pack of cigarettes that says, caution, predictions are hazardous to your health. Okay, you just never know. And so therefore, trying to break out the crystal ball and predict whether the Pope or the Church writ large is going to zig or zag is in some ways a pointless enterprise. I would suggest, however, that the value of trying to look down the line about what might be coming is not so much what it tells us about tomorrow, rather what it tells us about today. It gives us license to step back from the kind of rattle and hum, the constant noise of today's headlines and whatever happens to be breaking at the moment. And try to take in the big picture, try to focus on those deep currents that are working their way through Catholic life today and carrying us towards our tomorrow. So that's point one. We will be doing some prognostication in a limited way here today, but that's not the value of the presentation. The value of the presentation instead is to try to start a conversation about what those megatrends are right now that we can identify. And try to put ourselves in a position to think intelligently about which direction we want to nudge them as they go forward. All right. Secondly, my own limits as a prognosticator, I could give you any number of failed predictions that are part of my checkered history. But let me give you the most notorious. As the Archbishop mentioned, I have published 10 books. Two of them were biographies of Pope Benedict XVI. One written before his election, the other written afterwards. I'll have something to say about the book I read afterwards a little bit later, but for now, the book written before his election, which came out in 1999, the last chapter of which contained, ladies and gentlemen, four reasons why he would never be elected pope. A point that the Holy Father has found occasion to remind me of more than once over the years. So listen, Nostradamus I ain't, okay? That's the point. Your guess is as good as mine, literally. About what's actually going to happen tomorrow. But that said, we're going to try to do some heavy lifting here this morning. What I'm going to do, just to get us into the game plan, I'm going to try to lay out for you three of what I would see as megatrends in Catholic life today. Three of those deep currents currently making their way through the church and kind of setting the stage for our tomorrow. Two of these megatrends are going to be global in scope, and one of them is going to be particularly focused on the United States. Okay? And we're going to try to do the two global ones here during our time together this morning. We'll do the American Catholic megatrend this afternoon. The game plan, I know you have the schedule in front of you, but just so you know what's coming. I'm going to be talking until probably a little before 11, and then we will take a break. We'll come back, we'll have some conversation at your tables, then we'll come back together as a group, do some Q&A. Then we'll get to the heart of the affair, which is lunch. And by the way, Archbishop, as heroic as I thought your performance during the Synod was, my one little criticism is that you didn't stand up against what I think was the singular Vatican atrocity during the Synod period, which was scheduling briefings at 1 that typically lasted until 2:30 or 3, which utterly destroyed the Roman lunch. I mean,
I went to one as a sacrificial.
I went to all of them. Okay. And I listened to you guys for 3 weeks talk about preserving global culture. Like, you were destroying global culture right here. You know? I mean, believe me, the best part of covering the Vatican is Roman lunches and dinners. And yes, I know it's a real sacrifice of my work that so much of it is done over lengthy Italian meals. But I want you to know I am over there carrying the cross for all of you, except during Synod. All right. Anyway, so we'll have lunch, then we'll come back. I will talk a little bit more in the early part of the afternoon, and then we'll repeat the process with conversation at tables and then group conversation. Sound good? All right, I'm going to give you two global megatrends that I see in Catholic life today. I will mention them briefly, and then I will unpack each in turn. Megatrend number one is the rise of a world church. The rise of a world church. And megatrend number two, the rise of a church of martyrs. The rise of a church of martyrs. Okay. Let's start with the world church. The late Jesuit theologian Karl Rahner once said that in the long run of history, the Second Vatican Council in the mid-1960s would be remembered as that moment when Catholicism became a self-consciously global family of faith. That is no longer tied primarily to its European or Western heritage, but truly global. Now, Rahner is making a theological point. This is one of those rare cases in which you can find hardcore, take it to the bank, empirical confirmation of a theological intuition. Okay, let me do some basic math here. Okay, in 1900, at the dawn of the 20th century, there were 270 million baptized Roman Catholics in the world, 270 million. Of whom, 160 million lived in Europe and North America, okay, which meant a block of about 70, 80 million every place else. They were principally in Latin America. And this, of course, was before the population explosion of the 20th century. So in other words, just a little over 100 years ago, okay, the demographic profile of the Catholic Church was roughly what it had been at the time of the Council of Trent. Okay, it was an overwhelmingly white, first world family of faith. Okay? Now, flash forward to the year 2000, the end of the 20th century. At that stage, there were 1.2 billion Roman Catholics in the world. 1.2 billion, still roughly the same number today, although we're getting very close to 1.3. And of that number, 780 million lived outside the West. They lived in Latin America, in Asia, in Africa, in the Middle East, in the Pacific Islands. That's 360 million in the West, in what has traditionally been thought of as Christendom. In other words, we lived through a complete demographic inversion. Today, two-thirds of the world's Catholics live in the so-called developing world, and if we run the clock forward to mid-century, that is the year 2050, the projection is by that stage, the share of the Catholic population that lives outside the West will be three-quarters. In other words, within the arc of most of our lifetimes, 3 out of every 4 Catholic men, women, and children alive will be living in the developing world. Now this, ladies and gentlemen, is a classic example of what the social critic Neil Postman once described as organic rather than additive change. Okay, this isn't simply adding a new element to a pre-existing mix. Okay, this is one of those changes that everything becomes new all at once. Everything is transformed. Nothing is left untouched. When I was in graduate school, I had a professor, a history professor, who said that he could sum up all of Western history in one sentence. Okay? And his candidate for that sentence was, first the agricultural revolution happened, and then the industrial revolution. Okay, in his opinion, those were the two most important determining forces in shaping the arc of Western history. Well, in similar fashion, if you ask me to sum up 20th century Catholic history in one sentence, I would submit to you the best candidate is the center of gravity shifted from north to south. Center of gravity shifted from north to south. Now, that's a pretty staggering point. If you consider all the mammoth chapters of Catholic history we witnessed in the 20th century, right? The Lateran Pacts in 1929, the end of the papacy's in a captivity inside the walls of the Vatican, primed it for a new, robust role as a voice of conscience on the global stage. We've already mentioned Vatican II in the 1960s. The almost 27-year papacy of John Paul II, and on, I mean, all the other stuff we could mention. But I would suggest that in terms of long-term historical, cultural, demographic, and even theological and spiritual importance, okay, the shift in the center of gravity from the north to the south towers over them. Towers over them. Okay. Let me just make two brief observations about the significance of this shift. Okay? One, it calls for a new perspective on issues in the church, a new perspective. Again, let's do some basic math. I have already mentioned to you that as of today, okay, what are we, November 3rd, right? The 3rd of November, 2015, there are almost 1.3 billion baptized Roman Catholics in the world. There are roughly 68 million baptized Roman Catholics in the United States. Now, what that means, ladies and gentlemen, is that we American Catholics represent exactly 6% of the global Catholic population. 6%. Put another way, 94% of the Catholics in the world, in many important respects, ain't necessarily like us. Okay? And by the way, if you're ever wondering why the Pope is not thinking American thoughts when he gets out of bed in the morning, this might have something to do with it. You know, it's a bigger and more complicated church than we often imagine. Okay? The recently concluded Synod of Bishops, I think, was in some ways a great graduate seminar about the global complexities of trying to make decisions that have universal relevance for a church that is so wildly complex. Let me give you one example where this came home in utterly clear fashion. As you know, one of the hot button issues at this synod was the question of divorced and civilly remarried Catholics. That is, Catholics whose marriages break down and they get remarried outside the church, and whether they should or should not, under certain circumstances, be invited back to communion. Now, one of the leading voices of opposition to that proposal that emerged at both at the last synod and at this one came from the African bishops. Okay, who emerged as real protagonists, okay, really for the first time, I think, at the global level of the church. I mean, and if you want to know why, here's another piece of math that you might want to ponder. Do you know what the Catholic population of Sub-Saharan Africa was in 1900, at the beginning of the 20th century? 3.9 million. Do you know what it was at the end of the 20th century? 139 million. That, ladies and gentlemen, is a growth rate of 6,708%. I mean, put that in your pipe and smoke it, huh? 6,000, I don't care what line of work you're in. If you've got almost a 7,000% growth rate, that ain't too bad. Okay, and the African bishops are very conscious of being the leaders of the most rapidly growing and arguably the most dynamic Catholic community anywhere on the planet today. I covered the African Synod in 1994. I can tell you that many of the African bishops at that time came to that event in Rome feeling like junior partners in a multinational enterprise. That is clearly not the case anymore. This time, and both the last October and this October, the African bishops came to Rome determined to sit at the big kids' table, and ladies and gentlemen, did they ever. A famous book written about the Second Vatican Council was titled The Rhine Flows Into the Tiber, which was about the German influence on Vatican II. I suggested that if I ever wrote a book about these two synods, I would title it The Rhine Flows Into the Tiber Again and Hits the Zambezi. Okay? Because the African imprint on this event is man. Anyway, so on this issue of communion for the divorced and civilly remarried, the Africans, although I don't want to overgeneralize, many of them were among the strongest opponents of that idea. And one of the reasons it is because in their backyard, they will tell you, the fundamental pastoral challenge to marriage that they face often is not the situation of divorced and civilly remarried, which in Africa is relatively uncommon, though not rare. But the more common problem they face is polygamy. Many of them lead cultures in which polygamy is either approved formally, de jure, by the state, or de facto, it's accepted and encouraged by the culture. And what the Africans will tell you is, look, you know, we have spent two or three generations trying to convince our people that the Christian concept of marriage is one man, one woman for life. Okay? And if we start shifting the goalposts on that now, then how do we continue saying no to polygamy? In fact, Cardinal Francis Arensi, the great lion of Nigeria, although he wasn't actually in the Senate, a very important behind-the-scenes reference for many of the African prelates, Arensi did an interview with us at Crux, and I asked him, you know, what about polygamy? And I said, are you worried that if the church gives in on the divorce and remarried, it's also going to face pressure on polygamy? And he said, I'm not worried about it. I'm certain. I know that's exactly what would happen. And he said, and in fact, the guy in a polygamous relationship might have a better argument. Because, you know, what he could say is, okay, yeah, I've got a second wife, but I didn't kick the first one out. I mean, you know, she's still there. I'm still taking care of her. I didn't walk away from her. So, you know, his point being that anybody could make a credible moral case for an accommodation, it might actually be the guy in a polygamous relationship rather than the guy in a civil remarriage. In any event, point is, I think when we Westerners get around a table and we talk about divorce and remarriage, polygamy is generally not the first thing that springs to our minds, right? It's generally not in the mix as a factor that we feel compelled to think about, because it's not a reality in our backyards, but it certainly is a reality in the backyards of bishops from Africa, bishops from many parts of the Middle East, and bishops from some parts of Asia. My point about perspective is this. If you want to think intelligently about the Catholic Church in the early 21st century, there are really only two entrees on the menu, okay? Either you are going to think globally, or you are going to think dysfunctional. Okay, those are the only two choices you have. If, and I emphasize if there ever was a time when it was possible to understand the Catholic Church exclusively through the prism of American experiences, American concerns, and American priorities, okay, that era is definitively closed. Okay, we're living in a new world, ladies and gentlemen, okay, in which fixes to problems that seem obvious to us, okay, answers to questions that seem blindingly clear to us, are not going to play that way in many other parts of the Catholic world. And I would add to that, the era in which we can dictate solutions simply because we're America and the rest of the world isn't, you know, that era is also. Okay, we are in a new sort of multipolar reality in the Catholic Church. And if you want to have a conversation about virtually any issue in the life of the Church today, you have to ask not only how does this play for us, but also how is it going to play in Eastern Europe? How is it going to play in the Middle East? How is it going to play in Africa? How is it going to play on the Indian subcontinent versus the Philippines? You have to make careful distinctions like that. Okay. So that's point one. We have to have an utterly new perspective, a thoroughly global perspective for thinking about issues in the church. Secondly, we also need to understand that part of that global perspective is that the narrative that we are familiar with, the narrative that we have grown up with about Catholic fortunes in our time, is precisely that. It is our narrative. It isn't necessarily the global narrative. And I'll give you the obvious case in point. The missionary fortunes of the church in the 20th century. What is the dominant narrative about Catholic fortunes in America today? Basically, the narrative is one of decline, right? You know, we read studies from the Pew Forum that tell us that one out of every 10 adult Americans today is an ex-Catholic, right? You know, we read the Catholic share of the American population has dropped from 25% to 22%. You know, we see careful pastoral research about where these exits have gone, where they have ended up, and so on. And that the, you know, fastest growing segment of the American population from a religious point of view is the unaffiliated. They're what sociologists call the nuns, Okay, not N-U-N, obviously, but N-O-N-E. Okay, and that kind of nun is growing like gangbusters in the United States, whereas overall, it depends on what part of the country you're in, but overall, Catholic population is in decline, fairly significant decline. Now, look, I mean, obviously, that has to be of concern to us. It has to be a pastoral concern at the retail level. And further, you know, if this is what you see in your own backyard, that is, if you see parishes closing or clustering, schools closing or clustering, you know, it's becoming increasingly difficult to keep Catholic hospitals afloat. If it's more difficult to pass the faith on to the next generation, then obviously, if those are the realities in your own backyard, they're very true to your experience. However, ladies and gentlemen, I am here to tell you, they are not the global story of the Catholic Church in our time. Instead, the global story of the Catholic Church in our time is that we are living through the most rapid period of missionary expansion of Catholicism in its more than 2,000 years of history. Again, the Catholic population in the 20th century shot up from 270 million souls to 1.2 billion, and that wasn't just because we lived through a population boom. The population boom in the 20th century can account for about two-thirds of that increase, but one-third of it is sheer missionary evangelical hustle. Okay, and you see this all over the world. Africa is the most pronounced example. I've already run the numbers there. One of the things that means is that not only is the church in Africa growing dramatically, but it is also remarkably young. Remarkably young. The estimate is that something like 75% of the Catholic population of Africa today is under the age of 25. Okay? I mean, and it's one thing to say this, it's another thing to see it. I've been in and out of Africa several times over the years. I was just there in August. In Nigeria for a reporting assignment. And I tell you, when you go to the typical Catholic parish in almost anywhere in sub-Saharan Africa, half of the time you don't know if you're in a church or a daycare center, okay? Because kids are literally hanging from the rafters. I mean, there's just a kind of, and of course we all know what that means psychologically. Youth implies optimism, it implies hope, it implies a purchase on the future, and there definitely is that spirit. About the church in Africa. But it's not just Africa. I mean, Northeast India, for example, ironically enough, in an area that has been hard hit by significant waves of anti-Christian persecution, there's also been significant expansion of the church there. In South Korea, Catholics went, overall, Christians are about 25% of the population today, up from about 11% just a generation ago. The Catholic share of the South Korean population has grown from about 3% to around 15 to 17%. Depending on whose estimate you want to look at. My point is that do not be seduced by the narrative of decline, okay? Because decline may be the story of the church in some parts of the United States, certainly is the story of the church in some parts of Europe, but it is not the global story, okay? And instead, the global Catholic story in our time is runaway, mammoth, breakneck, astronomic expansion. Okay, astronomic expansion. And therefore, one of the primary challenges for us going forward as a faith community is going to be to consolidate that expansion. Because just as decline poses a set of problems, so does growth. Right? You know, how do you keep up with it all? Let me give you one practical point where I think the chickens are going to come home to roost on this question. In the United States, where do we get a taste of this global church? Well, the truth is, all you have to do is walk out the door, right? I mean, our own congregations are mind-bendingly diverse. But probably where this rise of the world church becomes most visible for us at the retail level, that is, in our parishes, is the increasing reliance on foreign priests in the American church, right? I mean, the estimate is that one-third of all the priests currently serving in the United States today are foreign-born. We add about 300 international priests every year in the United States. I mean, listen, folks, I don't know about Louisville, but there are some dioceses in this country where if you had to kick out all of the Nigerians, Filipinos, Indians, Koreans, and Vietnamese tomorrow, you might as well put a going-out-of-business sign in the cathedral and shut out the lights on your way out, because the party's over. Okay? So this is often where this reality of the global value of the church comes home to us. Now, Let me say that I think the presence of these foreign priests, I see them as kind of ambassadors to the other 94% of the Catholic world. I think they're a great blessing. But there's also some hard pastoral questions that have to be asked about our increasing reliance, I would almost say dependence, on these foreign clergy. Because here's the reality. It is not as if the church in the developing world has a priest surplus. Now, you might think they must, because they're growing so rapidly, and it's true that seminaries in many parts of the developing world are bursting at the seams. I mean, you take the bigger Memorial Seminary in southeastern Nigeria, which is Ibo-Lan, which is the heart of Catholic culture in Nigeria. That major seminary by itself has a student population of 1,500. That's basically a third of all the Catholic seminarians in the United States today. Okay, in one major seminary. By the way, they have five major seminaries in Nigeria. It's not the only one, it just happens to be the biggest. However, that does not mean that there is any priest surplus there or in any other part of the developing world. And if you think about it for a moment, okay, the reason will be clear. What is easier to do in the Catholic Church? Baptize somebody or ordain? How much time does it take to baptize somebody versus how much time does it take to ordain? Point is, rapid growth is a prescription for making priest shortages worse, not better. Because your population grows much more rapidly than your core of priests does. What's one of the numbers? Do you know what the priest-to-person ratio is in the United States, that is the ratio of priests to baptized Catholics in this country? It's 1 to 1,300. We have one priest for every 1,300 baptized Catholics. It's more or less the same in Europe. Do you know what it is in sub-Saharan Africa? It's 1 to 5,500 and becoming worse by the day. Do you know what it is in Latin America? It's 1 to 7,800. Do you know what it is in Southeast Asia? It is 1 to 8,300. In other words, however bad you may think our priest shortage is in the United States, it is infinitely worse in most other parts of the Catholic world. Now, given that, why are all these priests coming to the United States? Well, I mean, in part, it's because the church in the developing world feels a very strong call to what they often term the reverse mission. Okay, the idea is that they were evangelized by the West a century or more ago, and now it's their turn to pay back. Okay, so there is a theological conviction behind it, but let's face it, that's not the only reason. Okay, another very common reason is, to be quite honest with you, money. Okay, the priests come here to study because they find support to do that, or they come here to serve. And often that creates a revenue stream for the home diocese in several ways. In some cases, although not all bishops would do this, but some bishops may actually pay some kind of direct compensation to the sending bishop to compensate him for the loss of the priest. Many bishops don't want to do that because they don't want it to look like they're poaching. But once that priest is here, often three things are true. One, he may send a portion of his salary back home, either to support his family, or to support his religious community, or to support his diocese. Two, he may have the opportunity to network with Catholic foundations and movements and associations that would be in a position to support the local church in the place he comes from. And three, quite often, he can hit the homily circuit in the summer, you know, when guys go around covering pastors when they're on vacations. And during missionary appeals, you know, he can also raise some money for his home diocese or his community or his country, okay? So let's not make, it is wonderful that those opportunities are available, okay? So there's nothing crass or illicit or corrupting. But it is a fact, it is nevertheless a fact, that there is a risk of a kind of brain drain where an increasing share of young clergy from the developing world is being attracted to the developed world, okay, at a time when actually the need for that clergy is much more acute at home than it is here. Let me put it to you this way. If assistance analysts, okay, and by the way, the Vatican has hired every consultant and systems analyst in the world in the last 3 years, so why this question hasn't come up, I don't know. But if a systems analyst were to look at deployment of people and personnel in the Catholic Church, I suspect the first thing that would smack you in the face is that two-thirds of our people are in the global south, but two-thirds of our clergy and three-quarters of our bishops are in the global north. Okay, there is a clear mismatch here. And I think as a church, going forward, as an American church, as part of that church in the developed world, one of the questions we're going to have to ask ourselves is there a way that we can be of support to our brothers and sisters in the faith in the developing world that doesn't involve skimming off an increasing share of their clergy? That, in other words, that doesn't involve sort of breaking the back of the church, destroying the village in an effort to save it, right? That's a question that we're going to have to wrestle with, and it's one of the phenomena of what it means to live and move and have our being in a global church. Now, we could go on and on. I could give you plenty of other examples of the consequential character, the transformative character of what this rise of the world church means, but I will just leave it at this point, that increasingly there is no issue, no aspect of Catholic life, however narrow or local or parochial it may seem to you at first blush, there simply is no question, no topic, no subject that can be intelligently analyzed or resolved without thinking about its global ramifications, okay, the global dimensions of the issue. Increasingly, it is an anachronism, okay, to talk anymore about the local church in the sense of a kind of hermetically sealed, independent operation with only nominal connections to the rest of the Catholic world. I mean, we live in a world, ladies and gentlemen, in which if something happens in the church in Chile, or the church in Botswana, or the church in Bahrain, today, it will become a global phenomenon within 5 minutes, and 5 minutes after that, I will be getting phone calls wanting to know why the Vatican hasn't had a reaction to it. Okay? So the local today is, by definition, the global. Okay? So therefore, we have to think.